Yeah, basically my interest in the use of psychology in police investigation arose when I was investigating a case of serial murder. This consisted of seven murders, took place within a very short span of a couple of months and in a small area. And the first three murder cases were wrongly detected. Someone had some gang war, someone had last seen theory and so on. But after the third crime, we realized that we are going in the wrong direction. These crimes looked apparently without any motive. And so we had to really think of ways that we had not thought of in our career. I was a superintendent of police that time in a district called Barampur. These murders came to be known as the Stone Man murders. That created my interest in the use of psychology in investigation of crime, particularly more complicated crimes. And that is the time when I came across a word called offender profiling. Now, offender profiling was popularized by the Behavioral Science Unit of the Federal Bureau of Investigation at Quantico, Virginia. Three, four special agents claimed that they are able to detect very difficult crimes, particularly murders or stranger crimes, where you do not know who has committed the crime, by deeply analyzing the crime scene. So they divided the crime scenes into three categories: an organized crime scene, a disorganized crime scene, and a hybrid crime scene. An organized crime scene would mean that the criminal, the offender, has carefully chosen the time, place of attack. And he has carried out what is called staging. That is, after committing the crime, he has tried to conceal evidence by tampering with it, by making it look like something different. For example, he has committed a murder, but he has tried to make it appear as if it is a suicide, something like that. Or he makes it very difficult for you to detect the dead body. So that is the kind of crime, or he tampers with the dead body so much that it is difficult to identify the dead body. This is called an organized crime scene. A disorganized crime scene would mean that it's a spontaneous attack, largely an attack of chance, sudden provocation, and the use of force is far in excess of what is actually needed to kill a person. It's a brutal attack. No one can be killed more than once. But a disorganized criminal goes on attacking even after the person is dead, and even interacts with the dead body in some way or the other, including necrophilia and whole lot of activities that can be done with the dead body, preserving the dead body, and so on. So that is a disorganized kind of a crime scene. And the third is what we call a hybrid crime scene, which is where you find partly it is organized, partly planned, partly unplanned. Now, the offender profiling program meant that by analyzing the crime scene from a behavioral point of view as to how the offender interacted with the crime scene or how the offender interacted with the victim, what did he really say? What did he really do? How did he conduct himself? From that, we can deduct certain conclusions about who might have committed the crime. What would be his age profile? How educated would he be? Would he be a prolific offender? Would he have previous background in burglary? Or would he have some previous association with crime and so on? So, the linking of crime scene behavior Two, demographic details of an offender, that is his age, educational background, sex, and other features is what is called offender profiling. So on the one hand, you have what happened in the crime, and the other, who committed the crime. Now, if you can connect these two, that is looking at the crime scene, looking at what has happened in the crime scene, you are able to guess or predict who might have committed the crime, then you can help the police in two different ways. First is you can help them to narrow down suspect list, or you can tell the police where to search for the possible suspect. And these are cases where police officers have absolutely no clue. So they're looking for some help. So can you give some clue on who has committed this crime? So this is how psychologists got attracted to this particular program called offender profiling, because in the federal FBI or in US, whatever takes place immediately becomes, is converted into a Hollywood effect. You know, we call it Hollywood effect, because you will then have TV serials, you will have novels, you will have books. So then there was a set of fictional psychologists who came to existence with Crackers, Hackers, and a whole lot of movies. Whole lot of movies came up. Silence of the Lambs is another movie. So a lot of movies came up, and that drew attraction of various people. Now, can I be the psychologist who can be that cracker, be that profiler? And very strangely, many girls got attracted to becoming offender profiler. And they started joining various forensic science courses, thinking that, you know, this is what would enable them to become some kind of modern day Sherlock Holmes, where they can go to the crime scene, look at the crime scene, analyze what has happened, and then tell the police who done it. Now, once this popularity of this program started spreading across the world, every country almost started having its own offender profiling program. And that is the time when academic psychologists started interrogating, started carefully looking at what exactly is happening. Is it really possible for psychologists to look at the crime scene, analyze it, and help police officers in detecting cases? Now, the conclusion that came from this extensive research was that it is not possible. Because if we are saying that offender behavior can be a basis of concluding who has committed the crime, then why is it only limited to only the most ghastly of crimes like serial crimes, a serial murder? Why can't we be wise enough to even apply the same techniques for burglaries? Or for that matter, the question that came up was, if we can predict who is committing the crime, then why can't we detect other cases? Why only a particular set of cases where we are saying we had success? So once we looked at the data and how this process was working as a scientific methodology, at a philosophical level, at a methodological level, we found that it is not conforming to any of the known methods of psychology. It's not part of experimental psychology. It's not part of any ethnographic study. It's not part of any type of research which is really, really valid in scientifically. Now, then the question that would come to your mind as students would be, that is it that then psychologists have nothing to do with the detection of crime? The answer is no. Yes, we can. And I will explain some of the ways in which psychologists can help detection of crime. The first thing that we found was, if you look at crime scene behavior, let us divide it into two parts. One is where the crime was committed, that is geographical behavior. and second, how the crime was committed. What we found is that when an offender decides to commit a crime, it is not an arbitrary choice. A burglar does not decide to commit a crime at any place at random. There is a logic. Now, you can model his thinking by using, let's say, a rational choice model, where he is making a calculation of risks and benefits. He knows that after committing the crime, he has to go back to his home base. So he does not want to take the kind of risk where he will be caught with stolen property on the way. So if I'm an offender, I would not commit crime in the vicinity of where I live, because there is a possibility that I'll be detected. And beyond, after some distance, let's say 2 kilometers or 3 kilometers, I might start thinking that now I am safe. But I would also not go beyond 10 kilometers because after committing the crime, I have to go back. So I have to maximize my chances of committing a crime and minimize the risk. And this logic of maximizing opportunities and minimizing risk led people to commit crime in particular ways. So geographical profiling or geographical offender profiling became a very well established aspect of investigative psychology with Kim Rossmo, a Canadian police officer, and David Cantor and others writing extensively. And these were based on empirical research. So how do you do an empirical research on geographical behavior of a criminal? There is one paper that I published in Journal of Investigative Psychology and Offender Profiling, where I looked at burglars who are serial burglars, and I tried to find out how far are they willing to commit, how far are they willing to go to commit a crime. This is called journey to commit crime. Are they willing to go 30 kilometers, 40 kilometers, 50 kilometers? How far are they willing to go? Now, we found typically that an Indian burglar is not willing to go more than 2.5 kilometers or 2.7 kilometers in the series that we looked at. Does that mean to say there are no traveling criminals? Yes, there are traveling criminals. So we found two types of geographical offending. One is called marauding. Marauding means wherever you are, you commit crime in and around, in that vicinity, in that locality. And most of the burglars, most of the criminals commit crime in the vicinity. And then there are the travelers who travel long distance, but these are extremely rare phenomena. There are particular groups who commit crime by traveling. So there are travelers and there are marauders. Therefore, when a crime takes place, there are means and ways of understanding what might have happened in that particular crime scene in terms of geographical behavior, in terms of suspect prioritization. Who should be your suspect? That would require that police authorities organize their crime data of where offenders are located and where they commit crime using some kind of a GIS database. And then thereafter, it would be possible to carry out suspect prioritization. Now, as many of you are forensic psychologists, this is not an evidence that you can present in the court of law, but you can present it to investigating officers as investigative support advice. So there are two types of advice we give in investigative psychology. One is where we are clear that this is scientific enough to be presented as evidence in court, and we can give that. The other is where we say, look, this is not something that you can present in the court as conclusive evidence, but you can present it as investigative support system, something like you do in polygraphs or other things. The other areas where we found the interaction between offender and crime behavior interesting, offender and the crime scene interesting, is that in many of the crimes, the behaviors are very, there are a bunch of activities which takes place in every crime. If there is a rape, you know what all will take place. We found in through extensive research in investigative psychology that what we can do is put them in a format where we can find out exceptions in that particular crime behavior. What is common is not very interesting. What is exceptional, or what we call is the signature of the crime. So we found the concept of modus operandi, which traditionally is used by police officers, is not very helpful. To say that somebody has a modus operandi of burglary, that does not help at all. What is important is to identify signatures. What is unique in that modus operandi? And the third thing that we found through extensive empirical research is that there is no such offender who whose modus operandi or signature remains constant over a period of time. In fact, very often when I have been consulted by my friends for stranger crimes, like let's say stranger rape, and they are trying to look at whether the offender would have previous involvement in a rape, I tell them, no, it is not likely. It is more likely that this offender would have a background in burglary. So it is very difficult for police officers to understand that a burglar can also commit a stranger crime like a stranger rape. In fact, it happened in Mumbai. There was a case of rape, and the then police commissioner contacted me to find out what might have happened. I said, look, do not prioritize, do not search for people who have previous offending behavior in sexual assault cases. It may be pure burglars. So there is what is called criminal growth. All of us grow and change. Similarly, offenders grow and change. They learn from each other. They learn from prison. They learn from court trials. And this process of growth is often not very well understood by police officers. The only way psychologists can work with the police organizations is to carry out extensive empirical study into individuals and crime scenes, organize the crime data into structured databases, and then use various computer modeling to find out how you can predict criminal behavior. Unless we have standard models established, it's very, very difficult for us to really make sense of it or offer any opinion. When you are asked for an opinion on any topic, as a psychologist, the way you go, this is a standard format that as a student of psychology, I follow. And this is the practice in all British universities. I was in Liverpool, that they spend almost a week training you in ethics. The first thing that you do is to explain who has asked you for an opinion. Second, you say that what qualifies you to give an opinion on this subject. Are you a gynecologist so that you are giving an opinion on gynecology? Are you a neurosurgeon so you are going to do a neurosurgery? If not, do not venture into giving opinions. I often see people who have a clinical background and absolutely no background whatsoever in investigative psychology or forensic psychology, or who do not have any clue to criminal investigation, coming on television and giving opinions. Do not do that. That's not done. And that's the second thing. Third is define the questions. Fourth, give your opinions. Fifth, tell the person who has given you advice where he can seek a second opinion. And always, seventh, always explain the margin of error in what opinion you are giving. Cite a set of research literatures, peer-reviewed research on the basis of which you are giving your advice. Otherwise, you are trying to claim too much, and that would not stand scrutiny. I did help a particular defense case where I found the psychologist had given some opinion, absolutely clueless why they had given that opinion. They did not know how to structure a report. So this is one area where I would expect we have number of academics to train their students not to give their give up the cuff remarks and opinions to the court, because your commitment must be to science, not to the prosecution, not to the defense. You must be scientific. Otherwise, your opinion can bias the court. It can lead to miscarriage of justice. So that you must be very, very careful about. Besides these areas where you can work on, work with police investigations, organizing their data, creating their research base, and explaining to them that, look, my ability to help you will depend on my research. If I have looked at 100 rape cases and what happened in 100 rape cases, then the 101st or the 102nd rape case, I can tell you what might have happened. But I need data. I need to organize that data. I need to look into that data. I need to organize it into a model. Then only in the new rape case one more rape case that you're investigating, I can explain. You cannot, if I have not looked at 100 cases, I cannot explain to you what happened in the 101st case. So my past research is my only way of helping you out in the future cases. If I have not done any past research, there's no way I can help you. I cannot really, you know, imagine something and tell you something, because that will mislead you completely. That would take your resources, you know, waste your resources, time and energy. So the other two areas where investigative interviewing is one area, the two areas where investigative psychology can be of great help is interviewing techniques. Our police officers are simply untrained when it comes to talking to witnesses and suspects, and they're getting into serious trouble. Now the Supreme Court has said that all of them, everything that goes on in the police station will have to be recorded on CCTV, video and audio. I really do not know how the Indian police will face this challenge, because our officers are just not trained how to handle. The possibility of somebody beating somebody, threatening somebody, blackmailing somebody is gone. Now lawfully carrying out a police interview would require a lot of collaboration between psychologists and police departments. Police officers have to be trained in investigative psychology, in cognitive psychology, cognitive interviewing, in conversation management, and whole lot of activities. Because interviewing or talking to people is something that psychologists have been doing for the last 150 years. And this interviewing skill has to be now brought into the police department. Police departments can delay, switch over to a modern ways of interviewing only by another 2, 3, 5 years, but inevitably that is coming. So forensic psychologists and student of forensic psychology will have a lot to do, a lot to contribute. And the last area I will touch upon and stop there, because I would leave 15 minutes for your students and others to ask questions, is about risk assessment in various situations. Risk assessment when it comes to, let's say, domestic violence. There is a case of domestic violence reported. So whether you should register a case, arrest the husband, or you can enter into counseling. Whether there is a case of stalking reported, whether you should arrest and end that young man's career, or you should take a lenient view. Risk assessment in terms of allowing people to go on parole in the prison system. Today, the prison system does not depend on psychological reports from psychologists or social workers for deciding who should be granted parole. Now, that's another huge area where a lot of good things can be done. There are a lot of people who can be allowed to go out on the basis of risk assessment. Similarly, if there is a prison population, there are risks of self-harm to these individuals, and that risk assessment has to be done by a properly trained clinician. Then there are areas like statement validity analysis, and a whole lot of areas of psychology where police investigation, police departments, and the criminal justice system can benefit a great deal. But we have not started, we have not made a beginning in India. I got trained in UK, and I always felt that at some point, some of the Indian universities will start investigative psychology, but it did not work out, because most of the jobs in psychology are in clinical areas. So our undergraduate and postgraduate courses focused largely on clinical areas because students have to get a job. So unless posts are created or jobs are created where we train as like a student in investigative psychology, but thereafter he must or she must find a job. But now that is where there is a serious lack, serious gap. We do not have enough jobs in prison establishment, in police establishment, in various investigative support systems, in the decision-making process. And as a result, very difficult to attract good students to investigative psychology. So a lot of collaboration is required between police organizations and academic setups, and jobs have to be created. Only then we can expect all these various ways of psychologists coming to aid investigation can work out. Thank you, Ranjit. These are some random ideas that came to my mind when you asked me to introduce the subject of investigative psychology.